Now by Pat Quinn. He's the Democratic governor of Illinois, joins us from Chicago. Governor, thank you for taking a few minutes this morning. So, I mean, I'll start with that news for people who've been keeping an eye on this race and maybe not watching it that closely nationally. I think a lot of them looked at your political positioning this year and said, you're a governor who's in trouble. And this poll this week caught them by surprise. So tell us what has happened to give you a significant lead in the poll in Illinois right now.
Well, polls come and go. I work hard every day. I think the election's 45 days from today, Steve. 90 of you don't sleep, and I haven't been sleeping that much. When you campaign, you got to go across our state. We have a very big state, and one of the most important issues is raising the minimum wage. We have a referendum on the ballot this November 4th. We want people to come out and vote yes for raising the minimum wage to at least $10 in our state. My opponent, who's a billionaire with 9 homes, is for eliminating the minimum wage. So there's a real choice that people have. And there's a principle as old as the Bible. If you work 40 hours a week, you shouldn't have to live in poverty. And that's what raising the minimum wage is all about. And we have a grassroots campaign. That's what I've always done in my life, organize people at the grassroots. And that's how we're going to win.
Yes, you say your opponent, Bruce Rauner, has admitted that he previously said he doesn't support the concept of the minimum wage, but now says he no longer holds that position. But on that issue then of the minimum wage, so Illinois' level right now is $8.25 an hour. You say there's this non-binding referendum that's going to be on the ballot in November. You're for it. The criticism of you, and I think your opponents made this criticism, is they say you're a Democratic governor, you have a Democratic state legislature, you're in a Democratic state, you've been in office for 5 years now. If you want the minimum wage increased, why has not the minimum wage been increased while you've been governor?
Well, we've done it before. We did it in 2003 and in 2006. I was part of the effort that raised
our state
minimum wage.
But since you've become governor in 2009.
Yeah. Well, you build a majority. That's how you win. The best way to, I think, get this done this year is to have the voice of the people of our state encourage legislators of both parties to vote yes on raising the minimum wage. There was a poll that just came out the other day showing substantial public support for this issue. But that's how we just passed marriage equality last year in Illinois. And we did it by building a majority. And that's what democracy is all about. And I've been involved in passing petitions and putting referendums on the ballot my whole political life. And sometimes you go to the ballot box with the people to get the politicians to listen better.
You know, the same poll that shows you now running ahead of your Republican opponent also shows, though, your overall approval rating still not exactly that robust. It clocks it in at 36% right now, your approval rating in the same poll that has you running ahead. Maybe one of the reasons for that, I look at this race and I say, you were faced with something a lot of governors were faced with a couple years ago. Pension shortfall, the economy had crashed, revenue was sort of deprived and depleted in your state. You did it something that a lot of other governors didn't do, though. You raised taxes. It was a 67% increase in the personal income tax rate in Illinois. That was scheduled when you passed that in 2011. It was supposed to be a temporary increase in the state personal income tax that would begin expiring next year. You are now telling voters that you want to keep this tax increase permanently. Is that correct?
Yeah, well, I believe in taxes should be based on ability to pay, and that's why the income tax is much fairer than any other tax. Nobody likes paying taxes, but we got to pay for our schools and our health care. In Illinois, we've added 668,000 people to health care coverage under the Affordable Care Act, and I want to make sure we properly invest in things like health and education, public safety, and my proposal also puts major property tax relief as well as tax reform, including doubling the value of the earned income tax credit. So really, I think the best way to go is to take on what my opponent wants to do, which is give himself $1 million tax cut. Millionaire, he wants $1 million tax cut, and then shift the burden on the working people who live from paycheck to paycheck. He wants to slap taxes like on garbage pickup and things like that. That's unfair, and I don't think we should have that in our state or any other place.
I got to ask you, though, just because we think so much about the cynicism that's out there towards politics, towards politicians in general. You know, it exists towards leaders in both parties, certainly. You look at approval ratings like for Congress or something, and I look at this issue of the tax increase you did in Illinois, and you're making a case right now for why the state needs the revenue, what that revenue pays for it. And you can certainly go out there and make, and you are making a compelling case for that. But at the same time, when you guys put this tax increase through in 2011, you said it would be temporary. And it seems to me that if you say a tax increase, a 67% tax increase is going to be temporary, you schedule it to be temporary, and then once it's on the books, you start saying, well, actually, we need the money. It pays for this. It pays for that. Doesn't that contribute to that public cynicism?
No, well, what I said when I signed the proposal 4 years ago, I said, with respect to any taxes, we have to look at it every day, every week, every month, every year. I did not say that this particular matter would not be reexamined. I said when I signed the bill, we have to take a look at it as a situation presents itself. You know, Illinois has made a very good economic comeback. We've had the steepest decline in unemployment in the last 30 years in our state. The other day we announced 13,800 new jobs. So unemployment is down. Jobs are up, but at the same time, we don't want to hurt our recovery by having extreme radical cuts in our education, our health care, our public safety. These are fundamental things that have helped our economy come back, and we're not going back to where we were. You know, we inherited this mess from George Bush and the Great Recession, and I don't want to have that happen to our state. Some of the same things that are happening in Kansas, we don't want to have happen in Illinois with radical cuts in education that will harm our economic recovery.
Bruce Brown, the Republican, is also trying to hit you on issues of corruption, on issues of clean government. You know, Illinois is a state, obviously, with some somewhat of a seedy political tradition. Three recent governors have gone to prison out there. One thing that he's talking about is a hiring scandal involving the Department of Transportation out there, where there's been a report from the Inspector General who's looked at this and said that over the last decade, there have been about 245 people. These are basically, largely, these are friends politically connected to major Democratic politicians, you might call them cronies, who've gotten jobs they basically were not supposed to get. There were supposed to be anti-patronage mechanisms in place. There were ways that were found around this, and 245 people got these jobs. Your administration announced this week that a lot of those people, you say, you decided they should keep their jobs. Why, when the public's trust was sort of short-circuited like that, should people in those jobs keep them?
Well, it's a little more complicated than you just described. Number one, the Inspector General is independent. I gave, by law, in an executive order, the Inspector General authority over looking at any kind of matters of hiring, whether it's in that department or any other department. The Inspector General issued a report, gave it to me. I followed every single recommendation of the Inspector General, and then went beyond that. We're putting a merit board together for that Department of Transportation. I appointed a new Secretary of Transportation, a decorated veteran, a Rhodes Scholar, someone who will follow the hiring rules to the T, and is carrying out the mission of the Inspector General outlined for all of us. So, you know, whenever you see a problem in government, I take action. I take responsibility. I'm running against someone who is a private equity person who had a health care company that the U.S. attorney in Georgia said took $13 million from Medicaid and didn't provide proper care to vulnerable people. So there's a clear difference. That person, my opponent, ran out the door to collect millions of dollars with this company. And I think it's important that when something doesn't go right, you take responsibility and take action. I'm running against somebody who only takes the money.
There was also stories this week, and we mentioned this in the introduction, about more federal subpoenas that went out this week. There's also been your former chief of staff who was subpoenaed in relation to this issue with the Neighborhood Recovery Initiative. This is an anti-violence initiative that you undertook, your administration undertook, in and around Chicago 4 years ago. Obviously, violence, violent crime, a major issue in Chicago right now, but basically, the idea, this was a $55 million program where there was an audit that found it was hastily implemented. It failed to target the highest crime areas. The money was not tracked, and it relied heavily on Chicago politicians in terms of distributing the money. The question I would ask you is, again, we say that this history in Illinois of sort of corrupt government, of lack of faith people have in government often in Illinois, people looking at your administration and saying, you've been there for 5 years, there's the Department of Transportation issue we just talked about, and then there's this issue with this federal investigation. Would it be fair for people to look at it and say, Pat Quinn, maybe he means well, but he hasn't changed the culture of government in Illinois?
Well, that's exactly wrong. I have changed the culture of government in Illinois. I inherited a mess when I became governor. We had one governor, former governor, in jail, another one going to jail. We've passed strong ethics laws that I enforce. I got recall passed as a constitutional amendment in our state. We had to reform our pension systems. My opponent, as a matter of fact, got $50 million from one of our pension systems when it turned out that he had a swindler on the pension board on his payroll. So there is a need for strong ethics all the time. That's what I've done my whole life in Illinois, and I think the voters know that. It's going to be a tough campaign. I'm running against a billionaire who has more money than King Midas, but we have grassroots democracy. That's what I believe in.
All right, my thanks to Illinois Governor Pat Quinn.